Take my life, Holy Spirit, and place me now upon the altar of praise. Place me now upon the altar of your fire as a living sacrifice, holy. I am yours, you are mine. Husband me, your husbandry. Husbandman, husband me. I'm your husbandry. Husbandman, I belong to you. Husband me, I'm your husband's ring. Husbandman, I belong to thee. Husband me, husbandry. You're my husband man. I belong. Take our lives, Holy Spirit, like an offering. Place us now upon your altar. Place us now upon your altar of praise as a living sacrifice will be as a living sacrifice. Let your fire burn. I'm your husbandry. My husband man, I belong to thee. Oh God, I'm thine. Oh God, husband me. I'm your husbandry, Lord. My husband man, I belong to thee. Oh God, my husband me, you, I'm your husbandry, Lord. Husband man, I belong to thee, oh God. Holy Spirit, take my life. Place me on the altar of praise. Let your fire fall. Let your fire burn. Yeah. Take my life, place me on the altar. altar of praise, and let your fire fall, let your fire burn, Lord, in me. Oh, oh, Holy Spirit, take my life and place me on the altar of praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me, oh God. Oh, Holy Spirit, take my life and place me on the altar of praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me, oh God. Oh, Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on the altar of praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me. Husband me. I am your husbandry. I'm your husbandry. My husbandman. My husbandman. Woo! I belong to thee. Husband me, I'm your husbandry, my husbandman. I belong to thee. Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me. Holy Spirit, take my life. Oh, Holy Spirit, take my life. Place me on your altar, place me on your altar of praise. Let your fire fall, and let your fire burn in me, oh God. Husband me, I'm your husbandry, my husband. I belong to thee. Woo! Husband me, I'm your husbandry, my husband man. I belong to thee, God. Oh, husband me, I'm your husbandry, my husbandman. I belong to thee, oh God. Take my life, place me on your altar of praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn, burn in me, Lord, oh God, to do on your altar of praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me. Husband me, I'm your husbandry. My husband,
Jesus. Father, you're amazing.
I belong to thee, O God, Father, my Lord Jesus, O husband. I'm your husbandry, oh God, my husbandman,
my father.
I belong to thee, Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me. Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on your altar of praise. Let your fire, let your fire, I bow my knee, I bow my will to the Father of every family. In heaven and earth, thy will be done, O God, in me, O Lord. Husband me, I'm your husbandry, my husband. I belong to thee, husband thee,
Father, thank you.
I'm your husbandry, my husbandman. I belong to thee. Father, I bow my knee
unto the Father of every family name in heaven and earth. Your will be done, O God, in me. Your will be done.
Husband me, I'm your husbandry, my husbandman. I belong to thee, Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on your altar. A praise, let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me. Husband me, I'm your husbandry, my husbandman. I belong to thee.
And I bow my knee to the Father of every family in heaven and in earth. Thy will be done, O God, in me. Your will be done. I bow my knee to the Father of every family in heaven, oh, and in earth. Thy will be done, O God, in me. Your will be done.
Husband me, I'm your husbandry. My husbandman, I belong to thee. Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me. Oh, do it again. Oh, Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on your altar of praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me. Husband me, I'm your husbandry. My husband, man, I belong to you. Jesus said, my Father is the husbandman. I'm the vine and you're the branches. I mean, we got it made. Woo! Husband. I'm your husbandry. My husband, man, I belong to thee. Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on your altar of praise. Let your fire fall and let your fire burn in me.
Do it one more time. Do it again with me.
Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on your altar of praise, and let your fire fall and let your fire burn in me. See it now. Watch him do it right now. See him do it. Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on your altar of praise, and let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me.
Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on your altar of praise, and let your fire fall, and let your fire burn. Yeah.
Oh, Holy Spirit, take my life. Place me on your altar of praise and let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me. Do it again. Oh, Holy Spirit, and take my life. Place me on your altar of praise and let your fire fall and let your fire burn. Yeah.
Husband me. I'm your husbandry. My husbandman,
I belong to
a
husbandman. I'm your husbandry,
my husbandman.
Woo!
I belong to you. Just one more time to try to keep up. A husband me. I'm your husbandry.
Hallelujah.
My husband man.
Hallelujah.
I belong. Just one more time, everybody watching on the web in here. Holy Spirit, take my life. Place me on your altar of praise and let your fire fall. And let your fire burn in me.
See it now.
Holy Spirit, take my life. Place me on your altar of praise. Let your fire fall and let your fire burn in me. Husband me.
Oh.
I'm your husbandry.
Oh yeah! Oh yeah!
My husbandman.
Oh, mighty God!
I belong to thee.
Ho ho!
Husbandman.
I'm your husbandry. Oh God,
my husbandman, I belong to thee. One more time, I bow my knee
to the Father of every family name in heaven and earth. Thy will be done, O God, in me, thy will be done. I bow my knee to the Father of every family in heaven and earth. Thy will be done, O God, in me. I will be done. Father, I bow my knee to the Father of every family name in heaven and earth. Thy will be done, O God, in me. Thy will be done. done.
Husband me, I'm your husbandry. My husbandman, I belong to thee. Husband me,
Jesus,
I'm your husbandry. My husbandman, I belong to thee.
Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on your altar of praise, and let your fire fall. Yeah, let your fire burn in me. Take my life, place me on the altar of your praise, and let your fire fall, and let your fire. Your will be done.
Father, we thank you tonight. It is in your plan and your purpose not only to take this nation, but every nation and shake it to its very foundation. Father, we thank you that you have come and purposed to glorify your only begotten Son in our lives in this place tonight, right now. Do you come to shape us, to mold us, to build us up, to strengthen us, to show us how to move into the realms of fully cooperating with you, oh God, that your will may be done in our life, that your glory may be made manifest through us, that your Son be revealed in every person. Lord, that the bright shining of your divine power and glory would be seen here in the United States of America, and everything else would become obsolete. A president would become meaningless. A Senate would become meaningless. A Congress would become meaningless. A Supreme Court would become meaningless. The governments and the power of men, nothingness, like dust scattered to the wind. Dust scattered to the wind. Lord, let your church arise, and oh God, we know, Father, that you alone, oh God, have already purposed it, and you're waiting for your people to say, let God arise, let your church arise, let your glory arise, let your will, your work, your power be made manifest, O Lord, in hearts dedicated and devoted to you. Everybody shout to the Lord. Lift your voice and shout, shout, shout to the Lord. Everybody shout to the Lord. Lift your voice and shout to the Lord. Shout. Lift your voice and shout to the Lord. Most High, shout to the Lord. Let the walls come doubling down. Let every force of the enemy be broken. Let every power of the enemy be stayed. Lift your voice and shout to the Lord. Shout, shout, shout. Shout to the Most High. Shout. Shout to the Lord. Lift your voice to the Redeemer. Lift your voice to the one who preserves men. Lift your voice, lift your voice. Lift your voice and pray. Lift your voice. Lift your voice. Lift your voice and shout to the Lord. Shout, 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 shout.
you to be as fallen and stained. Lift your voice and shout. Shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord. Lift your voice and shout. What's God worth? She shouts to the Lord. Shout the shout of praise. Shout the shout of praise. Shout, 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 shout. Shout, 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 shout. Shout the shout of praise. Hallelujah. Oh God. Shout the shout of praise through me, through these, oh God, to praise. Shout the shout of praise. We shout the shout, shout the shout, we shout the shout, we shout the shout. Whoa, shout the shout, shout the shout, 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 to the shout, shout, shout to the Lord, shout, shout, shout. Shout to the Messiah of us, he black ash and above a hole. Shout to the Lord. Lord, receive that in you. Shout to Messiah. Shout to shout, shout to shout, 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 shout now, shout now, shout, 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 shout. Shall do every wall fall, shall do every mountain flees. Shall to stop the enemy, to stay the plague. Shall the shout of praise. Let the incense rise, let the shouts begin, let the praise be heard on high. For there's a people in the Lord. There's a people of the Lord of the earth who shout. Sabayamo, Sumayayamo, Kurosina. Shout the shout of praise. Shout the shout of praise. I'll praise, I'll praise. Shout the shout. Shout the shout. Shout the shout and dance the dance. And shout the shout and let the glory fall, the glory fill. This nation, this state, this place, oh God, we shout the shout. Every force of wickedness, every design of the enemy against this nation, in the name of Jesus Christ, we bring you down by the power that is in the name of Jesus. By the working of his mighty grace, yield up, yield up, yield up, yield up to God. Satan, you cannot have your way. This is the nation of the Lord. This is the people of God. This place belongs to the sanctified under the kingdom of Jesus Christ. Shout the shout, shout the shout. Shout, shout, shout. Shout the shout, shout the shout, shout and shout. Shout the shout, shout the shout. Shiloh, our God reigns. Our God reigns.
Only His will be done in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on your altar of praise, and let your fire fall, let your body burn. That's the shout, that's the shout of authority, that's the shout of praise, that's the shout that turns the day. That's the shout that causes a stone to stay. That's the shout that rules over all things. That's the shout that executes authority. That's the shout that makes disciples out of nations. That's the shout that raises up and pulls down. It builds and plants. Sunday alavoco se prahaya. Just shout. The shout, the shout, the shout, the shout. Right now, there are people shouting with a louder voice, with a, as it were, to rend the heavens and to rend the earth with the shout of their man, of their woman, of their person, of their cause, of the things that they are demanding that belong to the realms of darkness. Oh, let the people of God begin to shout. Let the people of God begin to lift up their voice. Let the people of God begin to make known a great noise in the earth. Let the people of God. Whoa. Susri la baba pierra boho sitaria baha. Susra la baba satai. Susra la baba baba. Shout the shout that subdues nations. Shout the shout that obtains promises. Shout the shout that saves America. Shout the shout that saves America. Shout the shout, shout the shout. Thy will be done. Thy will be done, O God, in heaven and earth. Shout the shout. Holy Spirit, take my life. Place me on your altar of praise, and let your fire fall, and let your fire burn in me. Men think that they fashion the earth, and they fashion and design the things that shall be, but they are deceived. For God Himself will be lifted up and exalted in the midst of His people if they would begin to show the shout of praise, if they would begin to move in His divine authority. Shout the shout of praise. Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall, and let your fire burn in me. Father, we bow our knee to the Father of every family name in heaven and earth. Your will be done, O God in me, and your will be done. We bring down the plans of men and the devices of men that would destroy that which God ordained and that which God has planted and that which God has raised up. We obey the voice of the Lord, and we begin to shout the shout of praise upon the altar of sacrifice. We shout the shout of praise. Husband me, Jesus, Father of me. I'm your husbandry. My husbandman. I belong to thee. Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on your altar of praise, and let your fire fall, and let your fire burn in me. Father, we thank you that you raise us up and you teach our hands to war, and you cause us to give place to your understanding heart, O Lord, that we may pray your prayers and sing your praise and shout your shouts and declare those things that you've ordained in the earth, and our voice be heard louder than the voices of men who lift up their voice to darkness and lift up their voice to the will of man and to the will of demons. Father, may your people be no longer silent and overwhelmed by the circumstances and the situations about them, O God, but may they begin, Lord, like never before, to shout, God. Hallelujah. Tonight, at this moment in time, we lift up our voice and cry with all of those whose ear attuned to the voice of the Spirit to hear what God the Holy Ghost is saying in this moment in time. And we turn the tide in the name of Jesus Christ, and the devices of nations and the devices of men and the devices of wicked men and demon spirits shall not be allowed to move forward. For we stay the day. We command the sun to stand still and the moon don't move. We say it is the day of the Lord. We say it is the time of his great outpouring. We command every sword to be put down. We command every violence of man to end. Shout the shout. Santo yalo babosia. Santo yalo babapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapapap
Oh, my masikeri, my shabrima, my sitina, my mahari. Oh, my masira, my mandala, la vakira, my masat, paranahiti. Lord, husband me. I'm your husband. My husband, I belong to thee. Well, I believe that God has raised us up by his Spirit to command the wind, to command the wave. God has raised us up by his Spirit to prophesy, to declare by his word what shall be, how it will turn out, what it will look like. That things will not be, as it were, designed by man, a popular vote, but God moving the hearts of the kings, God moving the hearts of men. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, my desire, my wish is that every one of you would learn how to cooperate with the Holy Spirit so that you would touch the move of God every day, just like this. You touch that realm of prayer and intercession that changes things, that produces a Holy Ghost supernatural event that can never be articulated by the thoughts of men or expressed by the energy of man. There's no motivation, nor passion, nor power outside the Holy Ghost to do it. It's my job explicitly to teach and instruct you in the ways of God that you may learn to yield yourself to the Holy Spirit, that you may learn to come under His control and His hand, and you must be coached and evaluated and trained. The name Jezebel means I have no Lord. I rebel against the Lord. I have no husbandman, in other words. I will not be husband. I will not be tended to. I will not be instructed. I will not be nurtured. A husband. I have no husband, you could actually say, is what her name means. I will have no husband. I will have no Lord over me. I have no one instruct me and tell me what to do. I'll submit to nothing. But such is not the ways of the Spirit of the Lord. For His ways are the ways of lowliness and meekness and servitude, that delights in the instruction, that delights in the cooperation, that delights in obedience. God's way is the way that is cooperative, agreeable, hallelujah, the hungry and thirsty and desiring. God places within man's heart the knowledge to understand, yes, that is God. Yes, this is the way, walk ye in it. There's nothing so wonderful as being willing to be husband. Husband me. This is what the Father says. This is what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. You may think it's the cunning abilities of men. You may have no spiritual understanding and limit it to a realm of that which is a human expression. But it's not the case. This is what God is saying. This is what God pleads. Men really don't plead with God much at all compared to how God pleads with men. To cooperate with Him, to move with Him, to be instructed by Him, be led by Him, be ruled by Him, be taught by Him, be built up by Him, be strengthened by Him, be mentored by Him. And if you can't love men whom you've seen, how can you say you love God whom you've not seen? And if you cannot be mentored by men under that authority of the Spirit of the living God, how can you say that you're being mentored by God? It's all the same thing. It's all the same thing. For it's the way that Father has designed it. I know that men don't like it. They base all of what they believe, for the most part, and what they will submit to based upon their own intellect and their own understanding. But there is not found within that realm the knowledge of the holy. The knowledge of God is not found there. Father has brought these things to us by His Holy Spirit. We must learn how to yield to Him, submit to Him. Hallelujah. Move with Him. And that's why we just say to the Holy Spirit, take my life. Place me now upon the altar of praise and let your fire fall. And let your fire burn in me, because it's His, it's my life being conformed in every way to that thing that He Himself expresses, my will in every way being taught only His will. Fire of God speaks more of passions and desire and emotion than it does anything else. Passion is fire. When the Lord Jesus said, the zeal of the Lord is eating me up, is consuming, that's fire. It's written of me. It's written, inscribed by the will of God. This is what you're going to do, and this is what you're going to be. And I submit myself to it. It is written of me, inscribed by God. This is what you're going to do, this is what you're going to be. And I submit myself to it, because you can choose not to. You can choose to run your life in the ways of men and the ruin of men, and all the time believe that you're serving God. For hundreds of thousands of men, and generation after generation, have done the same thing. The only thing that would ever make you and I any different is that we're willing to give ourselves over to seeking the Lord and being taught of God and coming to a place that there's nothing too great that He would demand. There's nothing too strict. There's nothing too high. There's nothing too costly that you would not easily turn your heart in obedience and say, "Oh God, I delight to do Thy will. I delight to do Thy will." Hallelujah. I say Cuba stays open. I say Kashmir stays open. I say the nations of the earth stay open. I say that the oppression will not be allowed to advance its cause across the earth, across this nation. I tell you, God does not need a man, and He does not need a woman. He does not need a Senate. He does not need a Congress. He does not need a Supreme Court. He needs a church. Now, the church is in need of people who put God first and above all other things, who desperately seek after the Lord in His presence, and no matter what God asks, you'll do it. No matter what price there is to pay, you'll pay it. No obedience is too great. I bow my knee to the Father of every family named in heaven and earth. Thy will be done, O God, in me. Your will be done, O God, in me. For this cause, I bow my knee unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family, or every family in heaven and earth, the complete and entirety of God's people are named. That through this act of submission and worship and consecration unto Him, He would grant you according to the will of His riches, according to the riches of His glory, to be strengthened with all might by His Spirit in the inner being, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. That you, being rooted and grounded in love, can step into all the fullness of God. Now listen, I want to just talk to you just a little bit here. So, hallelujah. Just come and hoshamanea shipokorinea halamondera sipa halasutane kula shikaro halamosiria tisamateka. Faith is the supernatural power of God given unto men to do His works. I said faith is the supernatural power of God given unto men to do His works, to move mountains out of the way, to rearrange the laws of nature, to say, sycamine tree, be plucked up out of the earth and go be planted over in the sea. To say whatever it is that God would inspire and demand to show forth His exploits in the earth through you and me, that it may be shown that there is one God who reigns supremely in the heavens. He's the Lord God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. A radical position God's called us to, much higher than the religious ideology that men have been entangled by and trapped by. I pray tonight that you come to understand that you can't live this and you can't have this unless you're willing to give your whole life, your whole being over to God. As long as there's compromises going on, as long as you hold on to your life, I don't care if it's 1%. As long as you hold on to your life, you can't have this that God is expressing through those who will have His life. And Father, in His love and mercy and kindness, shows us. He shows us where we're holding on to our own life. He's so patient, long-suffering, and merciful. He shows us where we're doing it our own way, where we're compromising, where we're polluting the mighty stream of his life and glory. And then if we'll respond to his reproof, if we will respond to his rebuke, then he will open up our understanding that we may know his word. He'll give us insight to understand his word. He retains all rights to revelation. It's God who comes and opens up our eyes so that we can see and know and understand the scriptures that gave us the insight to know how to move with the Holy Ghost. And see, the Lord doesn't make it a formula and he doesn't make it an intellectual process. It's a relationship. It's a love thing. He wants to, you can only hook up with God in a love thing. You've got to let the Holy Spirit take you, pick you up. He'll pick you up and carry you over to the altar. And lay you on the altar. So that you can begin to be a living sacrifice. So that you can begin to burn with the fire of his will, the fire of his glory, and the fire of his praise. Hallelujah. That's how I live. And what you discover is that there is a bursting forth of the glory of God that cannot be contained within your life. You'll find a passion and a motivation and inspiration that goes beyond all things that your own mind could convince you to participate with. God comes, moves in, and I'll tell you right now, the miracles and the excitement begins. Heaven begins to be opened. Heaven's rolled back like a scroll. Praise God. Your eyes are open. Praise the name of Jesus. And the wonderful things that you read about in the Bible become a living reality to you. You know, it's such a sad thought to think of that which the Spirit of the Lord reminded me of this morning, of how that in all of Israel, no one had honor for the true prophet. No one had honor for the prophet Elijah. Oh, yeah, now there's no prophet honored as much as Elijah. Even in every Passover, even in every celebration and feast. Right now, when the trumpets of Yom Tahurah was sounded, or what some people call Rosh Hashanah, it was a sound to cry out, oh, Elijah, come, return. But during the day that Elijah was upon the earth, nobody had honor for Elijah. The honor was for all the false prophets of Baal, false gods and false lords. They had no honor for the prophet of the living God. So Father had to send, what a testimony, the prophet into the country of the Phoenicians, those idol worshipers, those who followed after demon powers, literally the children of the devil made manifest. There was a woman in Zarephath who would honor the prophet and obey his voice. He would have gone to anybody in Israel and said, feed me first. And they'd say, get out of here. They'd run him off with a broom. They'd have sick the dog on him. But they said, God, find somebody of a stranger, because among his people, he could find no one who would obey. So Jesus also could find no one among his own people who would drink. So he had to go to the stranger and look in the place of a desperate woman who everybody else would have said is totally disqualified. She was willing to drink when none of his own people was willing to receive the water. Her response was, evermore, give me this water to drink. That there could be such a people today, not just a couple, not just one or two. God, you know, God in his mercy and his loving kindness, he steps in and he does a work of grace in some people's lives, in ministry's lives, to come and teach the rest of everyone else, so that you've got to imitate somebody. Amen. So that you can't walk in the pride of life and the haughtiness of your own understanding, and that you've figured it out, that you know it. Now you've got to be a foot washer. Now you've got to be a hand washer. Now you've got to learn how to imitate those who imitate God. You got to learn how to move in the Holy Spirit. This is the way the Lord, this is the way He does it. And then when there is big people that begin to come together and be baptized in the love of God, whoo, and there's love that passes knowledge, they begin to submit themselves to the will of God. I tell you right now, I hear the shouts of hell being silenced right now. I tell you, I hear the shouts of the demonic will being shut down right now. Amen. Why? Because somebody knows how to take hold of God. It doesn't take a lot of people. The Lord is limited to two. Jesus just said, I and my Father, we the witnesses. I'm nobody else in the earth, and He got the job done. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo! Father wants to move you into a place of understanding this life that He's given to us in Jesus Christ, that as a result of being captivated and overwhelmed by Him, you would hate your life in this world rather than trying to do it the other way around. There are so many people who try to sell all that they have to obtain a pearl that they've never seen. They try to sell all that they have to obtain a treasure in a field that they've never observed. That's religion. God wants to show you the pearl. He wants to show you the treasure hid in the field. He wants to show you the glorious life of Jesus. That you begin to disdain. Hallelujah. You begin to refuse everything that is human, everything that is earthly, everything that is corruptible, that just turns into something stinky. Amen. As God would say, is dung upon the earth is your end. A body that is corruptible, that bloats and deteriorates and is disgusting, and no one wants to be around your glory that you stare at in the mirror. That you nurture and tend to with all your heart. Oh, but there's something everlasting in the heavens. There's a tabernacle not made with hands. Hallelujah. The Father has fashioned for us. Woo! That we should be groaning to put on right now, to be clothed with that heavenly tabernacle, the building of the Lord, to be so excited. I'm telling you, this is how you move out of the culture of condemnation over into the culture of acceptance. This is how you move out of the realms of frustration and aggravation and doubt and unbelief over into the realms of this glory and this praise and this divine ability and faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I tell you right now, as soon as you go ahead and just move on in, I promise you, we won't be able to see much of you, because God has need of you throughout the nations of the earth. Father's looking to form you. We are school of the Spirit here. Hallelujah. Participating, cooperating with the Holy Ghost to train people how to move in God, how to yield to God. How to submit yourself to the Lord. There's rules. There's laws. Praise God. You got to learn them. If you refuse to learn them, you don't like the vessel God's given you now, He'll get you a worse one. One that you dislike even more. He'll move you into a worse situation. Because if this one ain't good enough, there's got to be a greater work upon the those things that really are holding you back. And Father has a way of doing it. There's no shortcuts with Him. Amen. You don't climb up some other way. You walk through the door. Amen. You come the high way, not the low way. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Faith is a supernatural ability to be able to change nations.
Amen.
To change nations. To subdue them. To subdue nations. To go and to prophesy over a nation and it changes. And God is using, well, God will use anyone who's desperate for Him. I mean, if God will use me, He'll use anyone. God used me to go into a nation and to prophesy to the nation and say to the nation, your war comes to an end. Your 40-year war comes to an end. From this day, the nation that has been opposed to Christianity will no longer look at you as a foe, but as an ally. God uses men to prophesy by His Spirit and move in this wonderful gifting of faith as we interact, as we're worshiping, as we're praising. Ann and I was standing that day, I'll never forget it, because God was there teaching me how to subdue nations. And I praise God for the training and the time that I had with other great men of God. But God was showing me some things right there that nobody was able to teach me, well, I was not able to see, though I served them. I served them. And my father is my witness. I served them faithfully. I didn't look for my own place or position nor desire. I didn't serve them faithfully. And it was an honor to be able to do that. But God then and that took me to that place and began to show me things as I was standing there, hallelujah, placed upon the altar of praise by the Holy Ghost. And I stand there just weeping, worshiping the Lord. Open vision comes. I see this. I saw a nation change. The nation has changed today. You can go and you can ask the president of the Alliance of Churches in the Nation of Nepal, and they'll tell you about this event that happened in 2006. Amen. God did a work. God did a miracle. I discovered that through faith we can subdue nations. We can go in and make a disciple of nations. We can prophesy. When I was with the emperor of the Congo several months ago, I was recounting many of these things that the Lord has done since that day in 2006. It's been a decade now. You know, it's been 10 years. You know, the Lord trains us. He teaches us our hands to war. He teaches us to move in His authority and in His strength so much that we go to draw back on the bow and the bow breaks. They got to get a stronger bow for us. Hallelujah. Because every arrow hits its mark in the Spirit. Every word is loaded with the faith of God. This is the supernatural ability of God to do His works upon the earth, to execute His will, to execute righteousness. And begins with our own life. It begins with our own choices. It begins with what we're going to do with the money in our pocket. It begins to do with what we're going to do with the desires that are in our heart, with the thoughts that run through our minds. With the time that we're afforded in this life, that we just think that somehow it's just expendable and we can just go ahead and use it whatever way we desire. All those things are lies, falsehoods. It's a mixture. Nobody wants to drink out of a polluted stream, especially God. Huh? You want to give Papa a drink? It needs to be a stream that flows from heaven and it's not polluted with your own will, with your own self-interest, with your own devices. You say, oh God, I bow my knee before the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom to whom and from whom every family, the whole family in heaven and earth is named. And we do so in recognizing that we come to Him and to petition the Father, who is our husbandman. The husbandman is the one who takes care of and tends and nurtures. He's the one responsible for the fruit. Huh? If the husbandman doesn't do the proper job, then what's going to happen is the vineyard will fail. The vine will not produce. But we got the greatest husbandman. Jesus said, my Father is the husbandman. I am the vine. We're not in some puny little, you know, degenerated, you know, vine that can't really produce very much. Nobody likes eating the grapes off of it anyways. It's just, where is the real deal kind of thing? We in it. Yes. We in the best vine that has ever been produced. Christ is Jesus. And He's called us to live and dwell in Him and find our whole life and identity and being in Him. And that, I'm telling you, begins to be a conflict at many points in our life. But Father has given us the ability to be well able to do it, well able to succeed. I mean, only Joshua and Caleb says we're well able to do it. I know it's, everybody's looking at the giants and everybody's looking at the land of impossibility and saying there's just no way we can inhabit that inheritance in God. And Joshua and Caleb, there's two among the millions saying, no, 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 we can do it. God has made us well able. We can do it. Amen. And so today, nothing's changed. It's the same. Today, it's the same. I pray that you won't be another statistic of those who defy God with your own knowledge and understanding, with your own reasoning, holding on to your own life, preserving your own interest. That's why they couldn't hear. They hung on to their own life. They're preserving their own interest. They were just thinking about, well, what if and what about? and all the catastrophes and all the possible negative scenarios. They couldn't trust God, agree with God, and trust Him and obey Him. Father said, if you be willing, but not just willing, but if you be willing and obedient, it's yours. You can have it. It belongs to you. Father has given us a realm of the supernatural, a realm of the spiritual, where we're seated together with Christ Jesus in the heavenly authority. His authority is above all principality and power and might. Understand this. He is above every wicked thing that exists, every demonic power that exists, every evil of men and devils. He's far above. And He seated us together with Him in that authority. He seated us together with Him in that place. He's given us the ability to walk in a realm of submission to Him where Satan cannot access us. He can't touch us. Wow. He gave us the authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. You know, He's recalling in that scripture there in Luke chapter 10. He's recalling when Satan came to defy God. Satan, who rebelled, the rebel, who would not have a husbandman, who would not be husband, rebelled against the Almighty and came out to throw down God. I mean, you know, he would just cast down to the ground like lightning. It didn't, you know, it was like a microsecond battle. You know what I'm saying? It's like, he's talking about stupid. Talk about an idiot. Talk about some brainless, deceived imp. He went from the wisdom of God to absolute fool. Oh, yeah. I was talking about him like this the other night and throwing and casting him down. Hallelujah. And, you know, he comes back with his counter punches. You know what? And he can't even touch me. Hallelujah. Well, you're going to have to understand how to come into a life and live a life of obedience and consecration to God. So that when he brings his counter punches, they don't terrify you. You're not going to retreat to your own self-interest and to your own security. Huh? When you lock your bedroom door and the devil walks in and unlocks it and opens the door and says, ha, ha, ha. And he's like, ha, ha, get out of you fast spirit of hell. Huh? When you're on a 47th floor of a building and somebody's outside your window banging on it and trying to threaten you, you're just like, shut up, devil. Hallelujah. God's in charge and you don't threaten me. Amen. He comes with all of his little wiggly stuff through the internet or through the television or through the mouths of people and the opinions of men, and you just aren't even moved. You say, no way. No way. You're not taking my authority from me. You're not subduing me with your lies and your witchcraft and your sorcery, your deception and your iniquity, your lawlessness. Father's looking to fortify and develop these things in you, but you can't hold on to your life and expect that God's going to be able to do that. You're going to have to decide you're going to give no more wiggle room to Satan, so you're going to begin to move into a deeper realm of faith. God has given you something that is His divine ability to do His works. It results in mountains being moved, the laws of nature being redefined. In other words, as I said, sycamine trees being uprooted from being planted in the earth to now going to be planted in the sea. That's redefining nature. The laws of nature. Do you see that? To subdue nations, to quench the violence of fire. Hallelujah. See, fire only burns what it burns at Father's command. Hallelujah. So if Father don't command it to burn you, you're good. You're good. And so the three Hebrew children discovered when they walked into the fiery flame that there was a dew of heaven and a gentle breeze about them. Hallelujah. That's what they said. There is a dew. I know that that is in the longer Septuagint version that some people have disqualified, but I qualify it. I'm telling you, they were there enjoying in a place surrounded by the sounds of angels praising in the face of Almighty God, smiling and shining upon them as they would only bow their knee to one. Oh, they could have justified it. They could have said, oh, just go ahead and do it. Act like it, but don't do it in your heart. Just act like it. They could have compromised as all the rest did that day. There were only three who remained standing. It says, Zero King. No matter what you say, whether we live or God is able to save us from your furnace. But whether he does or whether he doesn't, we're not obeying you. We will not obey the laws of men and of devils. We will not bow ourselves to demon spirits. We will rather take a hold of this life that has been enjoined unto us, where we can tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the devil, and nothing can hurt us. And the Father wants to train you in that when you're facing those challenging situations that just seem to be opposing circumstance and just seem to be everyday ordinary issues of life, God wants to begin to show you how to speak to the wind and the waves. He wants to begin to show you how to speak to the mountain of circumstances. Two hands for beginners. It's little things to deal with to start with. So it can get you ready. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody said all of the devils that couldn't make it overseas came to America. That's not true. I've discovered that if you can stand fast in God, stand fast in the faith, if you can not compromise in the Western world, it's all downhill from there. I mean, come on, people. Let Father raise you up because he wants to show you how to quench the violence of the fire, how to stop the mouths of lions, how to put the armies of the aliens to flight. Tonight, that's what was going on. We were putting the armies of the aliens to flight tonight. How? Upon the altar of praise with the shout. Now, listen, I know what's going on over here. Look over, you say, are you kidding me? No, I'm telling you the truth. You're trying to make more of yourself than you really are. No, it's impossible. Make more of myself than I really am. My goodness, I'm in God. God's in me. How can you make more of yourself? Come in, goodness, give me a break. That's huge. I've just agreed with God. I'm moving in him, man. Hallelujah. I don't need a whole bunch of other proofs. You know, I don't have to have a bunch of convincing arguments and other, you know, signs and wonders to prove it. God proved it when he said it and spoke it in his word. And that's when somebody agrees with God and obeys and begins to move with them. That is the expression of the divine power called faith. It's a divine power. It's not an intellectual ideology. It's not a philosophy. It's the divine power of God that Father wants to increase you in. He wants to strengthen you in it. He wants you to grow and develop in this wonderful gift that he's given you a measure of. That measure of faith can come into fullness of faith, to be full of faith. Stephen was full of faith and power, who did great signs and wonders among the people. I tell you right now, they're going to try to get rid of you quickly. Hallelujah. So I said, I want to be a martyr. Well, just start doing signs and wonders, and you'll be classified real quickly. Hi. Hallelujah. What a life, eh? What a life Father has invited us into. It's going to cost you. It's going to cost you all the things that you admire that is nothing but deceptions and lies and foolishness. You're going to have to leave the fashion of men and being formed and socialized and culturized and lobotomized. And no one would believe that they lobotomized, but you were, huh? By fifth grade. Right, fifth grade, you are taught the rules of men and you are so infected by them, but only the miracle of God, the Holy Ghost, can get you out of it. As a culture, to teach you how to rely upon yourself and be great in your own eyes. And how to take your place among men in a struggle to be someone. In the violent philosophy of the survival of the fittest. Our existence is a proof that that is a debunked idea. Right off the bat, I don't want to go into the proofs on that tonight. If this is the fittest, give me a break. What Father has done for us in Jesus, he gave us a measure of faith. Hallelujah. So that we might step in to cooperating with him, to live out his life, to enjoy him, to just find the place of being what God created us to be, to give him praise. We were created in him to praise him, to worship him. And it's not praise and worship as men would define it in the realms of the thinking of subjects to king. It's praise and worship and defined within the framework of a love interaction of, oh God, I love you because you put your love in me. I'm coming and discovering how much you love me. I'm coming discovering how you laid down your life for me, how you took basin and towel in the hand to wash my dirty feet, how you poured out your blood at Calvary to cleanse me from my sin. Oh, see, it's a different kind of praise and worship. It's not some subject bowing under some tyrannical reign now to give somebody something they need for their narcissistic state. Are you listening to me? His relationship, his hugs and kisses. Hallelujah. The deep calling unto deep. Hallelujah. The affection interacting with the affections of God. The passions of our life interacting with the passions of the Father. And in that, he begins to cause us to so integrate with his spirit, so integrate with his being, so integrate with his thinking, that all of a sudden we turn around and there's a storm and we say, stop it right now. I got aggravated with the wind the other day. It was blowing my string line around. I was trying to get some work. I got aggravated and I cried out, now stop it. And it shut down. Praise God. You just find yourself suddenly using all that energy and all of that stuff that you've been spending on yourself. It's all integrated with the Spirit of the Lord in the realms of the living God. The faith explodes just out of the actions of your life, naturally, instinctively. Hallelujah. 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 Prasateya. I'll tell you right now, there's going to be a bunch of jaw-dropping folks when I'm hanging out with Raul Castro and he's worshiping Jesus. And when I tell people, Fidel just gave his life to the Lord. And I have him on the platform to testify in his stadium that he built for his baseball team that seats 75,000 people, which he's going to pay for the advertisement, he's going to pay for the transportation, and he's going to give me the $100,000 a day stadium for free. Why? Why? Because I said, Holy Spirit, take my life and place me on the altar of praise and let your fire fall. And let your fire burn. And there was in that, could be raptured in the songs of the Spirit, caught away, because that's the only response that there would be to anyone who has a sincere heart. But then when all of a sudden you're faced with choices to make, it becomes a little bit harder of a press, because many people retreat and they hold on to themselves. And they baby themselves and say, I'm going to take care of me and my stuff. And the Lord says, no, surrender it to me. Give it all to me. I don't want you to have any other stuff. Give me your sword. Give me your shield. Throw that away. What else do you trust in? And he begins to shine the spotlight of heaven. Would you let God, the Holy Spirit, shine the spotlight of heaven upon your soul? And when you say that, you better be ready for him to show you the things you've been trusting in and holding on to. And he says, and he's going to hold this. And while you're praying from here on in, the spotlight's not going to move. It's going to be in that one thing that you're trusting in and holding on to. It's just going to stand, right? It's going to just beam down on that one thing. And every time you stand before the presence of the Lord, all you're going to see is that one thing. Until you're ready to say, I don't want that thing anymore. I'm done with that thing. Oh God, I just want to worship you. I don't want that in my life. Whatever's holding me back, I'll get rid of that thing. Burn it. Away with it. Destroy it. True. True. God's there long-suffering and patient as he comes to mentor us and lead us into the ways of life. He says, this is the way. Walk ye in it. This is the way. And he's pointing to Jesus. This is the way. And he's pointing to the Holy Spirit. This is the way. Walk ye in it, in him. Living in him. Hallelujah. If I can convince God's people that in reality, for realies, for true, we have been given the life of God to live it. We've been empowered with his ability. We've been empowered with his faith. We've been empowered with his authority. Now we've got to be willing to develop in it, because it's not going to be, you know, some fast food service thing. It's not going to be some kind of a quick thing. God is going to develop us as sons and that are filled with everything that he himself has. And, you know, I don't believe it has to take a lifetime. I don't believe that you have to sit around and be unfruitful for a lifetime. I believe that tonight you can step in to something that will suddenly cause you to be able to not just, I mean, if you're going to reach nations, you're going to have to start with a little community. You're going to have to start with your own life and your own house. You're going to have to be able to wake up in the morning and defeat whatever it is that's been holding you back. Huh? The fact, you know, the toast or whatever it is that's held you back. Huh? The paper being thrown in the wrong spot in the yard. Whatever it's held you back. Whatever's aggravated you. You're going to have to deal with that first. But God will develop you, and you don't have to spend, you know, years getting used to dealing with problematic things like the toast and the paper and the dog and the cat and the situations that should not even bother you at all. It should not even be an issue. You just be done with it. See, listen, I'm living for the King. I'm just captivated over here in this realm. All the rest of the stuff doesn't even matter. I don't care about the paper anyway. Whatever. You know, if we find it, we find it. If not, and I'm not going to concern myself with the bill, because Father's not concerned about the bill. Who cares? If we got to pay a couple of extra cents for the paper, because people are so nitpicky. I mean, a couple of cents off and they completely lost all their salvation. They completely come unglued. They completely become overwhelmed. It's a great catastrophe. The heavens are caving in. God's kingdom's on fire. His life is being threatened. I mean, it's like the whole end of the world has come, and it's just nothing. It's nothing. The overreacting of people is just absolutely a phenomenon. It's a phenomenon. We overreact on such little ridiculous things when we get to rather act upon such supernatural supply, where we say, I don't care about all those things. Hallelujah. Harabokashi yada haledeya. Haramamada shateya haya. Haranajala sataya. You know, for me, the clap is a sanctified thing that God ordained. And he said, clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. And he was saying so in light of his people receiving that which he had supplied, his mighty acts and his mighty deeds, which he was doing in their midst.
Amen.
It's a proper response. God's doing more than you're aware of. He's before you and behind you. He surrounds you when you lie down, when you rise up, when you go out, when you come in. Hallelujah. Haramandaya. He's your husbandman. You're his husbandry. It's about time you say, oh God, husband me. That's your response to what he's doing. That's your response, because he can be husbanding you, but you're not willing to be a husband. You're not willing to be under the rule. You're not willing to be nurtured. You're not willing to be guided. You're not willing to be trained. How many of you understand the Holy Spirit's come to train you? Yes. Oh, yeah. But you want it on your terms, on your turf, the way that your mind figures it should happen. And as soon as somebody's up in the radical reality of what's messing you up, you're all upset. Oh, yeah, come on now, because we done hit the pride of life. We done hit what's really wrong. All of a sudden, we've pointed out, hey, did you notice where the spotlight is? Yeah, that's right. Go ahead. Oh, that's true. Hallelujah. Come on, people. Come on. There is no price too great to pay to walk in that wonderful thing that God did when he sacrificed his own son for you and me so that we could step into his victory to be overcomers just like he overcame, to walk in such power and authority, to speak by his name, and everything must obey, to declare what God has said and it comes to pass, to speak it and it is done. I'm telling you, governments are about to get surprised when suddenly the church arises and they discover that something's far above all principality and power and might and dominion. Something's far above all governmental power, all authority. It's his church arisen in Christ Jesus for all the world to see. This is what God is saying. His word goes forth. His word is powerful enough to create within us all that he's ordained. Amen. Take a look at the stars. I love staring at the sky. I love imagining what it's like to be way out there. To just behold the beauty of it for what it is. Standing here on Father's earth. To behold all that it is, that he spoke into existence with his word, which he brought to pass and created by and through Christ Jesus. And nothing was made that I behold except that God did it through the one who became called Jesus. Eternally the Word. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh, and we beheld the glory of the only begotten Son of God, full of grace and truth. And I'm standing there looking at all that God did through Jesus Christ, and all that Jesus Christ did through the husbandman, the Father. And then I begin to think about all that he's created inside of me and the capacity. Oh, mycelium. And the devil comes to try to steal this from me and try to draw me out of the paradise of relationship and try to draw me into deception, to give me a knowledge that's not the knowledge of the Lord, to rob from me my insight, my wisdom, my fellowship, and my intimacy. And praise God, he's given me enough ability to see it for what it is and rise up with his divine authority and shut the thing down. Amen. The high praises of God in my mouth. A sharp two-edged sword in my hand. Ha-sa-paradea. Hallelujah. Suddenly I realized that God did something in our life that is greater than the authority in the archangel Michael's life. And then no forces of hell can take him on. And when him and Gabe team up, I'm telling you right now, there is no powers, no demonic powers that has been the princes over the great empires of the earth like Persia and Greece. Can't, all their imps and all their authorities can't stand against Gabe and Michael. Hallelujah. And Father has given us something in Christ Jesus that's far greater in authority and far greater in power and far greater in ability. And we're not willing to go to the first step of development because religion is a prison. Religion is a prison. That which culture would impose upon you and the identity that men would make you have and enslave your thoughts and minds and attitudes and actions and demeanor by. It holds you back from what God has freely given to us in Jesus. And he's inviting you to come and learn. He's inviting you to come and develop in the dance. Hallelujah. In the high praises. In the Zephaniah 3:17, where God says he's writing songs about you and me. He's dancing over us in his love. He wants to teach you how to dance too. Hallelujah. It's not some immodest, immoral thing. That's what Satan has done with it. It's something beautiful and holy and pure and glorious and powerful. Oh, the witch doctor found the dance of the demonic and he can do some pretty crazy things with it. But he can't hold a candle to you and me. Hallelujah. Dancing in the Holy Ghost. Learning the moves of the living God, because we're not restrained any longer by what culture has enslaved us by, by what society demands that we be, by what all the peers around you are shouting in your ear saying that you have to do. Uh-oh, the roar's out tonight. The growl is on. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, why, where does the growl come from? My response is pray a little more. Hallelujah. To look at who we are in Him and not believe anything else about ourselves. To lose where fear, all of its little demigods and all of its little influences lose all power. There is nothing insecure. There is nothing in any way that causes you defeat or discouragement. Fear has no place. Why? Because you let the Holy Ghost take you and place you on the altar of His praise. Hallelujah. And no matter what you're facing, you're like worshiping God, saying, yes, thank you, Lord Jesus. Let's just watch what God will do. So many times I've watched God work a miracle. My wife's watching right now. She was here and she could yell over the internet. We'll work on that later. She would tell you this is what happened. It wasn't too long ago. We was in a situation and, you know, and it's just intense. And it's the kind of situation that you can become overwhelmed by and frustrated by. And she was a little bit moved by it because she'd be husbanded by me. And she was a little moved by it. I said, don't worry about it. Forget about it. Do you see the weather outside? Talk about something different. Forget about it. It's in God's hands. But what about this? I'm not touching it. But could we do it? No, I'm not touching it. But how about if we? No, I'm not touching it. And somebody comes along and says, well, doesn't God expect you to act on something? Yeah, act on Him. Act in Him. To throw it all over into His department of you work it out. And so she tried to bring it up in the next, no, it's done. It's over. I've forgotten about it already. What are you talking about? This belongs to Dad. It belongs to Papa. I put it on the altar. It's gone. It has no attachment to my desire. I have no room in the department of desire. It's filled. It's filled with God. My heart's desire is filled with God. The department of desire has no more vacancies. No rooms available. Hallelujah. For any other concerns in this life, I keep my heart with all diligence. It's not hard when the Holy Ghost is allowed free course in your life. We watched the miracle of it take place yesterday. 3-4 months later. I called up my wife. It was either yesterday or today. I said, oh, by the way, guess what? The Lord done did it. It's all done. He all took care. He's all taken care of. Didn't take any effort on our part. There's many times where the Lord just has us just stand still and behold His salvation. We don't do nothing. We don't speak to nothing. We don't say nothing. We don't put forth no rod. We don't get down on our knees and pray and cry out to God. We just trust Him and say, no, it's Papa's. It belongs to Him. And it's not, I'm not going to think about it or feel about it. I won't get dream about it. Won't be an attitude in me. It's done. So I said, how can you do that? How can you put things out of your mind like that? Holy Spirit, take my life. Place me on the altar of your praise. I just go to worshiping Him. You get caught away in God, you'll forget about all your issues. Hallelujah. Because you get drunk in the Holy Ghost and you don't care no more. It's true. Come on now. I'm sorry it looks awkward to you. This is the party. This is where the real celebration is going down. Hey, this is where you really get loosened up. Woo! Hallelujah! bunch of old folks sitting around all, stiffened up and worried and tense and tight and concerned. Come on, man. Be converted. Become like a little child. Let's go play. Hallelujah. Let's go have some fun. Let's go do this. Let's go do this. Hallelujah. Woo. Hallelujah. Just living for the life. Just living for the life of it. I got a new puppy. It's a cattle dog. He's a cattle dog. And he's getting ready to be trained. But right now he gets to be a puppy. Just gets to be a puppy till training doesn't start yet. Gets to be a puppy. In the morning, he's just all excited because Bo's outside. And all he wants to do is go run and romp and play and bite and climb and do everything that he can do, enjoying just the little puppy's life. I get to enjoy the Jesus kind of life. I get to enjoy the Holy Ghost kind of life. And I'm trying to get some people to come on in and recognize, man, this is where the fun begins. Go ahead, get excited. You're going to have to make a transition from what you see after the seeing of your eye and what you hear after the fashion and the hearing of your ear. Because if you live your life based upon the five senses, you're stuck forever. You're stuck. Father wants you to be able to move the spiritual senses. Hallelujah. That the Word of God trains you and I to have, to be able to look into the unseen realm, to be able to hear things which have never been heard before and understand those things which have never entered into the thoughts or the considerations of men's hearts or understanding. That the Holy Ghost comes and says, hey, you guys want to see something really cool today? Why don't you just come with me? I'm going to show you some amazing things about eternal life. I'm going to show you some amazing things about holiness and righteousness. I'm going to show you some amazing things about the authority and the power of God that has been vested in you, that you've been equipped with, His inheritance that He's placed on the inside of you. I'm going to show you how to develop an explosive faith where you speak and it begins to happen, where you can begin to execute the righteousness of God and the judgments of God in the earth. You can't let people use you for their own cause. And you can't be a puppet on somebody's string and think you're getting somewhere. Don't be deceived. Because that's just about the height of every one of your jobs. And if you don't know it, eureka. The moment of discovery. Men just using you for merchandise, playing games with you that care nothing about you other than what they can profit from you. Give me a break. They'll use you as merchandise to sell their own cause. And it doesn't matter what you say and no matter how you play it, so long as they increase in their profits. Come on. Don't be foolish. Don't be unwise. Huh? But understand what the will of God is. Come redeem the times, for the days of evil. The days are evil. Be filled with the Holy Ghost. Speak to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Sing, make melody in your heart. Let the Holy Spirit place you upon the altar of His praise and call for the fire to come. Call for the fire of God to burn. Say, fire God, fall on me. Here's a sacrifice. Oh, Lord, I get up in the morning. It's not about living on what happened last year, what happened last month, what happened last week, what happened yesterday. I'm going to get up in the morning. I'm going to say, Lord, let your fire fall upon my life. Let your glory burn in me. Let your majesty be seen. Oh, God, I pray. Let your exploits come forth from my mouth. I want to change nations from my car by praying going down the road. Oh, hallelujah. I want to dream dreams and bring forth new things in God tonight, that when I wake up, I move in the authority of it. And if Satan tries to mess with me in any way, with some lying, harassing thing, we turn that thing against him double. Hallelujah. Double, hallelujah. Double injury, double consequences to the realms of his authority. Come on, people. It's time no longer to be moved by every wind of doctrine. It's time to no longer be moved by every wind of opinion, of all the ideas and propaganda of men, all the lying things that people are doing right now to set one man against another, to bring forth Satan's destruction and turmoil in the earth. To me, tonight, and the intercession during the worship time was really all about speaking the authority of God, having a voice that's louder than all the voices screaming for Hillary, all the voices screaming for Trump, all the voices screaming for this cause and that cause and the other cause, because it's a riotous thing tonight. It's a defiance against God. And never before has it happened on a Sunday night. Who are these uncircumcised who defy the armies of God? I'm not talking about men. I'm talking about demon spirits that play through men. And I praise God that I'm not sitting around in a stupor of self-consumption. What a disease. That I cannot sense nor hear nor understand what God is doing and moving by His Spirit more, but rather my very being are weapons of righteousness. My very being is a place where God can begin to shout forth His will in the earth, and nations subdued and nations changed and causes changed and things that Satan would try to advance, the enemy would try to advance, shut down. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. This is who you and I are. This is who we are. And we don't make it happen. We just slow. This is life. We're just doing this thing. How? Praising. Praise. Can I get it to you? Can I help you understand that this is where God develops within you all the wonderful things of His glory, as you just worship Him, as you enter, which is just nothing more than just loving on Him and saying, God, I just want Your life. I just want You. I want to be a part of Your family in a greater way, in a greater intimacy. I want to cooperate with You, Father, more fully. That's worship. That's worship. That's worship. We're stuck on just saying the same words. I praise You, Lord. Let's give You glory. Wait a minute. What does that all that mean? I love You. I'm on Your side. I want to do Your will. I want You to fashion everything in my life that is according to Your plan and purpose for me. I tell you right now, if you can get yourself detached from your money, you can start moving in faith to have finances, and you can see things come to you right, left, and center. I promise you. I'm going to go over here in Israel right now, because I feel it, because I live it. I feel it. As soon as I talk about it, I can feel the anointing of it. I was with a well man the other day. I'm telling you right now, so this guy, he doesn't know the Lord. He thinks he's just one of those guys way out in the sticks and is praying that the weather gets bad so nobody else moves into to the neighborhood. And the closest house is probably 10 miles away. You know what I'm saying? That kind of person. At any rate, I took him up to a spot, and I said, I want you to put a well here because there's going to be lots of water. He looks at me and says, you think so? I smiled real big. I felt the anointing. I said, I know so. And he's like, because he felt it. He felt that power. He felt that. He says, like a big gusher, huh? He's an old guy, too. He's been doing, well in geology all of his life, kind of thing. I think he said something, I don't remember, you have to ask Daniel if I've got it wrong, that he's like laid like, I don't know, something like 500 miles or 5,000 miles of pipe in the ground. But that day, he felt the anointing as I said, here comes Gusher right there. He says, you're working this water? Faith, the realm of faith. It doesn't need any evidence. It doesn't need any proof. It's going to be there because we spoke it, just like it's there because He spoke it. Because He just spoke through us, because He developed us in a partnership with Him. We're partners with God. Amen. Co-inheritors. Heirs of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Going to being fashioned and developed to judge angels. Mm. given a place as a gift to seated in an authority with Christ Jesus and now trained how to move in that authority upon our knees in prayer, upon our knees, not in whining and complaining, wishing God would do something. Where are you, God? Why aren't you doing more than you are? Think about it. Many prayers is bemoaning your circumstances and complaining that God should be doing more. Oh God, why, when, where, how, what? Why me? Why this? Why that? That's not prayer. That's not the prayer of faith. The prayer of faith that begins to do what Daniel did as he began to praise and magnify God and give thanks unto the Lord. Hallelujah. As the psalmist said, 7 times a day will I render praise unto your name and bow before you, God. Hallelujah. To say, you are sovereign, you are control, and nothing can defy your plan, your will. And when you know that you are centerpiece in his plan and his will, you're good. You are good to go. You're well provided for. You're well taken care of. And everything that God has promised will come to pass in your life because you are doing it. You're developing in it. You're letting God to develop you and grow and mature you in faith because you're cooperating with him. You're acknowledging him. You're saying, I agree with you, God. Hallelujah. Just imagine that every agreement that ever comes out of your mouth where you're agreeing with the word of God is strengthening in faith. Every praise, every worship, you're being developed. Every time you hear a sermon, every time you read the Bible.
Yes. Amen.
Every action and activity of the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
Is strengthening and developing you.
Jesus.
In the faith of God.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But you've got to get your affections. You got to become detached. The other day, they labeled Ruth Anna in the hospital a detached mother because she's got baby and they're coming and telling her all the negative scenarios and all the things that she might have to do and all the things, the bad things that might happen. And she's basically ignoring them, staring off into his face. Detached. I said, praise God, baby. I'm the leader of all detached. I want to be the king of detached. I want to be personified, detached from everything that man is saying and man is doing and man is believing, and totally attached to what God has declared and what God has said, totally detached from the seen and the natural, and totally attached to the unseen and the supernatural. For we look not on those things are seen. You might think that that is some kind of a paradox. We look on that which is not seen. That is where our desires are. Change. God demands it. Otherwise, you'll be stuck in whatever little expression of the Holy Ghost you have now.
Amen.
And that might seem glorious to you right now, but compared to what God's purpose to do, it's a shame. It is a shame compared to what God has purposed to do to fully reveal his son, Jesus Christ, in you and me. These works and greater works. I refuse to remain the same. I refuse to be confined. I refuse because God has demanded it not be that way. And I'm going to agree with his will. And I'm going to let God fashion me and develop me. I'm not giving my place over to Satan into the realms of the demonic. I'm not interested in the praises of men. Why are you infatuated by them? Says the Lord. You can't have his ways and his praise and his accommodation when you delight in the praises of men. You can't. Watch out, people. I watch as Satan does his plays, his little games, in so many different ways to stop men and to spoil them so that they can't develop. So that they can't be what God has created them to be. Don't get attached to these earthly things and these earthly interests. Don't allow those things like, which probably one of the biggest ones, money, finances, to have any place in your life. Two amens. Several reluctant yeses. And the rest stares. What do you mean? What I mean is take no thought for your life. What you should wear. And what you should eat. Did Elijah say that? No. Perhaps it was Moses. Mm-mm. Paul? Uh-uh. John? No. Peter? Nah. Jesus. The eternal word said, this is how faith works. This is how greatness in the kingdom works. This is how you develop in the things of the spirit. This is how you step into that place of total abandonment. I mean, what do you really need? I mean, think about it. Think about it. Joshua, think about it. He didn't have to worry about anything. He didn't have to do anything. He just got to hang around the glory all day long. The glory came on the tabernacle, and he's like, I'm staying here. You got work for me to do, let me know, but you'll find me here. This is how he gets to live his life. What's happening? He's captivated by the presence of the Lord. What does that develop in his life? Great faith. Great faith. To where he's just aggravated with the fact that the day is running short. Huh? You with me? He's aggravated. David, son, don't move. Mom, you stay right there. Don't you budge. Hallelujah. Worshiping, staring at the glory, being captivated by the presence of the living God. Come on now. Come on now. Where did Moses find the glory? There are too many people even sitting in this place tonight watching me by the web. You have done everything you can trying to cooperate with God. You killed the Egyptian and you broke up the argument before the brethren, and it's getting you nowhere but trouble. They're just getting you more aggravated. Time to come stand before the fire, because you'll never fulfill that which is burning in your heart, that which God has willed, till you come and behold the glory there in that presence of the living God. Beholding the fire of his glory, he began to have a burning passion, and he says, how do I know, how am I going to be able to prove it, how am I going to be able to convince him? He said, just do what I tell you and you can come back here and worship me. Hear it? The grand prize, the proof. You know, if you really look at it and you analyze it and go, wait, how are you gonna convince them with that? Hey guys, I'm gonna prove to you that God sent me. I get to go back and worship him. You know, you're like, people are looking at what? I get to go back and worship him. And you get to come with me. And oh, was it a day? Was it a day when they got there? Was it a day where they all got to hear audibly God speaking? Oh, you don't understand what I'm telling you, but I want you to know this right now, that if you begin to give yourself to loving on God and let God the Holy Spirit put you upon the altar of praise, you'll begin to understand what I'm talking about, and you'll begin to be consumed with an opportunity to come and worship, to become and interact, and to come and engage within this realm of divine power, because when it happens, suddenly, the authority of faith begins to be revealed to your life. Just because you stood there and praised. You stood there captivated with who he is. Jaw-dropping awe. Jaw-dropping awe. Awe, the awe of God. Hebrew word is yirah, which could also be translated fear. It's awe. An awe of his glory and his majesty and his beauty. And there he humbles himself to wash my feet, to take basin and towel in hand, to gird himself with the servant's cloth, to say, sit down and let me be your waiter. Come out to worship. If you'll come here, you'll begin to see it. You'll begin to love it. It won't be, oh my goodness, I got to walk in humility, or I got to walk in lowliness, I got to walk in meanness, I got to be servant to those guys. I got to be mentored by him. Or whatever, you know. You're just like captivated. You're just there worship, and worship turns into a place of such divine authority. As I was with Moses, so shall I be with you. As I honored him before the people, so shall I honor you. Go stand there. Watch what I will do this day. As I magnify myself through your life. Someone worshiping, captivated by his presence. And now the Lord has given to you and me such a greater opportunity. Something far more intimate, far more glorious. But we're too busy. Because we got a house. And we got a job. And people think we're like shining stars at what we do. And we're just so excited about ourselves. So excited about what we do. It interrupts the volume of praise. It runs counter to the rhythms of God. It runs counter to that which the Holy Spirit would produce within our life. Where all our affections are upon you, Lord. All our delights are in you. I set my affections upon things above. If you then be risen with Christ, if you stepped into this new kind of life, if you've been overwhelmed with the reality that God has given this inheritance and placed it in the inside of you, where you one with him and you now abide in him and he's your husbandman and he's husband and you're his husbandry and he's husbanding you to develop you into something that lasts for ages, the ages to come, time without end. See, and all of a sudden you have no problem taking no thought because you captivated. You captivated. Then in that captivation you go, oh, we need some finances. Money come. Pay the bill. Becomes my servant. Tables are turned. Can't serve God of mammon too. Men will be the servants of men. Servants of mammon. Servants of money. Huh? Satan is master of his craft. You listen to me. You try to take God's word and introduce your thoughts and your concepts and you have nothing but deception. And you'll never be mentored by God because you do not obey. You say you will go, but you do not do it. You can still get assimilated. You still get enveloped by the circumstance. The ploy of Satan. Satan knows what makes you tick. What made your daddy tick, your granddaddy, your great-granddaddy, your great-great-granddaddy, all the way back to Adam. He knows every in and out of you. He knows what excites you, what will move you. And if you give him an opportunity, he'll set it up to where you can't escape it. You can't escape his snare. There's only one way to escape the snare of the enemy. It's the word of God. It's the light unto your path. Yes. Hallelujah. There's only one way to escape the snare of the enemy is to have a relationship and a fellowship with the Father where he's husbanding you and he delivers your foot from every snare. Where you walk in the Holy Ghost and saying, God, I just want you. I don't care about anything. I'm not taking thought. I'm not taking thought for this. I'm not taking thought for what I wear, what I eat. I'm seeking first the kingdom of God. I'm over here worshiping the Lord. I'm over here captivated with God. I'm over here being developed in the realms of his praise, in the realms of his glory. I'm not going to put my hand to breaking up the argument. I'm not going to get involved with the arm of flesh to trying to work out my circumstances, organize the situation. Amen. I'm going to stand before the fire. You have to come to the end of yourself. It took Moses 40 years in the wilderness tending sheep. Sheep are tough to tend. They're constantly getting themselves stuck between two branches. If there's any mud, they will find it and they will be stuck. If there's any little crevice to get in and get their head trapped, they're trapped. It's just a continual fire drill of keeping the critters alive. If there's grass here and desert here, you will find them in the desert again and again. It's just crazy. If there's water here and there's no water over there, they will be over there. And you've got to go get them. 40 years to like forget it. 40 years to just forget about all that he learned in the palace, where he knew within himself from a child that greatness was in him. He knew from a child that greatness within him, that God had anointed, that there was a purpose in his life to deliver Israel. Stephen's testimony, Acts chapter 7, expounds on it by the Holy Ghost. But he had to go to a place to find out that his ability only stopped the flow of heaven's glory. The natural shut down the supernatural, the human, the divine. The doubt, the unbelief, the faith. The praises of men, the halls of men's fame, the glory of God. Listen to me. To where that he stood before the Lord and he said, how? Before he was an orator, but now he can't speak. Before he was a man of ability, but now all he has is a stick. All I have is a stick. This will be your tomorrow. What will you choose? Will you choose to delight yourself in you and have a big party and invite a bunch of people around you to celebrate you and them? Let's celebrate ourselves. We're doing so wonderful. And we feel so good about us. Go to places where people can't feel good about themselves and they can't have a party to celebrate each other. And they seem to move into faith much sooner. They seem to become more effective in the kingdom of God much sooner. They don't have to go through this tearing down so that God can build up, this uprooting so God can plant. It's just almost like this rich soil and God can come and plant and immediately it grows. There's nothing to tear down. They never built anything. God can come and build, and as he plants, and what grows is his glory. And what he builds is his identity and his divine power and purpose. Tonight, can I convince you that Father wants to take you into a place to begin to develop his greatness in you, that you can understand faith as the supernatural ability to do the works of God, that you cannot be trained in it so long as there's all of these other interests, so long as you're attached and you have your affections in something in this world. I'm going to tell you right now, Satan will make sure that you justify it just like the Mormons justify it and everybody else justifies it. And you come bow your knee. You kind of say, Lord, I'm nothing. There's nothing in this life that's valuable to me that suits me. You know, I think that one of the insightful things, I'm just trying to bring this thing to a close, but I got to say this, I just feel the passion on it, because you can't worship God and worship you too. You can't trust in God and trust in you too. You can't live for God and live for you too. You listen to me, because God says so. I'm laying it out for you, scripture upon scripture. I'm just summarizing it for you. This is the word of the Lord. Friend of mine was with the prophet in the Midwest. And this prophet has a great authority over demon spirits to cast them out. And one day, after having been in a meeting, a deliverance meeting, where many people were delivered from demon spirits and the powers of darkness, he had a vision. And in this vision, the devil came, was outside. Satan was outside and was beating on the window, saying, pointing in there, pointing at him and saying, I'm coming in there to destroy you. I'm coming in there to beat you to death. And threatening him from the outside, comes around, comes in the building, puts up his fist like he's going to fight and starts doing the thing, starts coming around him like, I'm taking you down, you're dead, I'm destroying you. And then goes, wow, I'm so impressed with you. You're really an amazing man of God. It's amazing your faithfulness and the authority that you come to in God. Starts bragging on him, because that so enters people's heart. They're so needy of other men's praise. They're so insecure. God wants to deliver you of that fear. God wants to deliver you of that fear. You got to ever have constantly have somebody tell you, do you love me now? Do you still love me? Do you still like me? Are you sure? Insecurity, fear, just craziness. You try to control it, but it's there in your eyes. And he says, you want me to show you how I deceived the angels, the mighty angels? And he's prancing back and forth and bragging on him. And the man of God, the prophet of God, said nothing. Just stood there looking at him. And he folded himself into a big accordion. And he began to play this beautiful music. The prophet of God said, most beautiful music I ever heard. And he began to sing praises unto God. He said the expressions that he had, the way he framed and wordsmithed, those expressions were so amazing, beyond any phrases in song. And if we worship God, verse after verse, chorus, first chorus, second chorus, third chorus, verse again, another one. A praise unto Almighty God, the creator of everything, the sovereign, the almighty. And at the very end, after all of these verses and stanzas and choruses of praise, he said, and worship me too. And so it comes so subtle with such a phrase that it's almost could be overlooked. But it's just there. It's just a little bit. It's just a little bit. Oh, can you see me? I'm doing so well. Do you recognize how well I'm doing? Isn't this amazing? Listen to me. Father's brought us into a place, an opportunity to have our lives hid in him, to be so honored, to be clothed with his majesty and his glory, that there is no right for us to lift our head and say, it's me. I have done this thing. There's no place for it because it's all him. He's done it for us. There's nothing but a posture of bowing before him. I need not the praises of men. I have his favor. I have his favor. I have his honor. I have his grace. I get to live out his place. Praise him and him alone, for it's in him. We just live for him, to do for him, to speak out these words for him. Yeah. Father wants to develop you in greatness. This is a day of exploits. This is a day to cast out devils, to have authority over the principalities and powers, the gods that are present at work right now within the framework of fallen angels that are manipulating the circumstances and situations of men, the affairs of state and of government, who planned the downfall of the United States of America, who planned to try to advance things into civil war and social conflict, to create upheaval, to disenfranchise everybody, to set every man against his neighbor, to try to shut down the move of God through violence. But there's men and women of faith who found this place of worshiping God, and in this place they begin to prophesy. They begin to speak. When I was with the emperor of the Congo a couple of months ago, he came to be 5 days in the meeting with us in Zambia. And while he's there, and it's always the way it works, while he's there, Satan created upheaval in the Congo. And suddenly, more war began to break out because the president that was there, the president of state that was there, was unwilling to step down. They were calling the emperor of the Congo to come back, to try to set things right, to try to calm down all the revolutionaries. And he was saying to another one of the chiefs in Zambia, saying, this isn't the right time for us to move in into the Congo with the gospel and with what we wanted to do. And the Lord just began to cause me to prophesy and say to him, look, this is the way the Lord has ordained it. That there is someone who comes with the authority of the Word of God and begins to speak out the purposes of God. And by speaking out what God has said and what God has willed, it shuts everything else down. People, you've got to learn how to do that with your own life personally first. But that ain't going to happen until your husband, Jezebel, has no Lord. She has no husband. She will not be husband. She will not belong to a husbandry. And it's the spirit that tries to work against the church and against the people of God. You got to decide, your people here tonight, where you stand. And just let God take you with all of your heart in response to Him and say, Lord, Holy Spirit, take me. Place me upon the altar of praise. Place me upon the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me. To bow your knee before the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom all the families in heaven and earth are named, that you might be granted by His power according to the riches of His glory, to be strengthened with all might in your inner being, that you, being rooted and planted in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the height and what is the breadth, what is the length and what is the depth, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and there be filled with all the fullness of God. Father is looking for someone who will not be polluted, who will not be diluted any longer with the affections placed upon this earth, with the praises of men, with the things that the human arm can produce. God's looking for some people who know how to be the master of finances and call it in, who know how to be the master of circumstances and shut down the wind and wave that contrary to what God has ordained and what God has commanded.
Yes.
It's time. It's time. You have to ask yourself tonight, what makes you different from the millions that have come before you that said, Lord, I will do it, but they never obeyed? What makes you different from the hundreds of millions that had the gospel preached to them, but it was never mixed with faith? It never was mixed. They were willing, but they weren't obedient. They delighted to be the people of God, to have the privilege to approach under the Lord, to say, I am one of the favored people of the Lord, but never to do what He had willed, never to live out the life that He had ordained. Tonight, let God search you out. Let God sort you out. Let God divide in your life light from darkness. Let God divide in your life truth from lie. Let God divide in your life those things that pertain to His life, that which only belongs to temporality, which is death and destruction. Tonight, let the Spirit of the Lord show you how to live in a pure flow of heaven, that you no longer have a defiled stream that has no water course but spews out into the streets, as the proverb says. That's a disaster, you know. It's good for nothing. It just creates problems, doesn't it? Tonight, separate yourself unto the Lord. As He's asking, He separated you. He said, you separate yourself now to me. And here's how I want you to separate yourself. This is what it looks like. I want you to come and rely upon me. I want you to come and trust me. I want you to come and be led by me. I want you to come and follow me. I want you to walk in my word. I want you to walk in my life. I want you to walk in my way. I'll be there to strengthen you. I'll be there to help you because I love you. I want to be your husbandman. I want to develop you. I want to produce in your life this fruit of fellowship, that whatever you ask me, I will do it. Think of it. Think of it tonight. Is there anything that you can do with the arm of flesh that could possibly compare to being able to ask the Father whatever you will and He does it? Is there any job that could ever supply for you? Is there anything that you could ever develop within the framework of your own efforts that could ever compare to the privilege and the power and divine ability to say whatever you want and God will do it? To believe that the Word of God is true. And to resign yourself to say, okay, Whatever the cost, it's not too pricey for me. Whatever you ask, oh God, so that you may develop me and train me in the exploits of faith to subdue nations, to quench the violence of fire, to stop the mouths of lions, to put the armies of the aliens to flight, to command mountains to be moved and cast into the sea, and they must obey, and whatever I say, it comes to pass. To see your works and these works and greater works. Sometimes I have a hard time talking about the miracles that we have seen, recognizing the greater miracles that Father has ordained that sanctifies His name. I want to sanctify His name. If I was sick, I'd never tell you. You'll never hear me talk about what the doctors did. I'll never, by His help and grace, do anything but sanctify His name. Why? I want to be wholly given over to God for the purposes of glorifying Jesus, that the exploits of God and the exploits of faith may not be compromised in my life. I'm going to give myself over, as Paul said, as he's trying to teach us the spiritual laws of life in Christ Jesus, of how to be led by the Spirit and walk in the Spirit, how to not be under the yoke of bondage or the fear, but to find ourselves living as sons, crying out from the depths of this wonderful divine power of God alive in us, saying, God is my dad, Abba Father, to find ourselves living in a place where we do not yield our members to anything that belongs to a natural, fleshly, human existence, earthly, confined place of the arm of flesh. Listen to me. God's looking for some mighty people. Don't abdicate. Amen. Don't come to a fork in the road and begin to have a divine opportunity in your life and then allow Satan sees a moment of divine opportunity, a moment of the movings of God, and he'll immediately try to come in and pollute it. He'll immediately try to come in and defile it. As he's defiled his sanctuaries, he'll defile your sanctuary. You hear me now? He's always there trying to ruin the move of God. And you and I must learn how to yield our members as weapons of righteousness unto God and only to Him. It's a sanctified life. It's a consecrated life. It's a consecrated walk. It's a place of continually saying, I want to be hid away in you, Christ Jesus, in every action and every move, being proven by the word that it is in you and wrought by you. And that takes us to great exploits in faith, because obedience to the Word of God, agreeing with the Word of God, obeying the Word of God, produces faith. Strengthens that measure of faith. Faith grows. Increases. And it's always there in proportion to obedience and servitude and being husband. It's always there, developing, as it were, simultaneously and directly proportional to the growing love and compassion of the person of Jesus Christ. The entrance, as it were, into all the fullness of God. Hallelujah. Jesus. Say Jesus.
Jesus.
To His... Yes. Hallelujah. Garamanda seteya. Mahana de fina labata seya. Harabasatara de magesha de yakara mahara. Maranda de se kidiara mahasi de yale. Havra mamandas. Havra de desia de la manda rosiri. If a man gives you a trophy, burn it. Lest it enters into your heart and defiles the crown that you had cast before His feet. Hear me. Pride of life is the most subtle of all. The praises of men defiles everything. Hear me. Hear me now. Hear me. Step into the moving of God. step into the movings of God through being placed upon the altars of praise, moving in the fire of God, and come to exploits. I don't know. Maybe you'll be there captivated for 40 years by the presence of the Lord. I tell you what, it won't matter to you. Captivated is captivated. Captivated means that you're not interested in anything else. You're doing everything you want. You've got it all right here. And then the Lord says, hey, come, stand here for me. Speak on my behalf. Oh, sipitarast. Kilimo soprane. Oh, shlimateash. They took Joseph and they bound him with chains. And they fettered his neck with a great yoke and threw him down to a dungeon that was dark. And there you heard him praising God. There, he learned how to rule in God's stead over everything and give him honor. Come on now. Come on now. There, he was confident that he could still interpret dreams and that God, who knew all things, would speak through him. Pretty radical, huh?
Yeah.
Circumstance did not dictate the relationship. Situations, events, did not in any way change his heart. I'm going to tell you a secret. Can I tell you a secret? The reason he was able, one of their strengths and the reasons that he was able to be delivered from the plot of Potiphar's wife was his father, Jacob, taught him that all other men were unclean spirits and to touch them would be to be so defiled that they would be cut off from God. His separation and his consecration to not interact, to personify that which would alienate him from God, kept him from the deceit and from the trap and the ploy of Satan. He ended up in prison. But that was the prison of men, and it was only temporal. For in the prison of men, he was delivered from the eternal prison of darkness because he kept the ways of God. He did not defile himself with all who were unclean because all men were unclean, demon-possessed, unclean of another sort. They alone were the family of God. That's what Jacob taught him. They alone were sanctified to stand in the presence of the Lord. That's what Jacob taught him. They alone. And that was handed down from tradition to tradition, from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob, from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob, all the way down to the days of Moshe. And the Lord articulated it more perfectly. A separation and a consecration. People, don't offer your children upon the altar of the world. Don't give them over to Moloch and to Chemosh and to all the things that this world is intoxicated by. Teach them the ways of God. Be separated and set apart unto the living God. Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness. Rather than reprove them, do not be friends with the world, carousing and cuddling with them. It is an abomination to God. He says you are the enemy, his enemy. It's an act of treason and hostility against him. It's true. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, and he brings the good news, but he's not friends with them. Do you hear me? He says friendship with the world is an act of hostility against God. It pollutes the river. It pollutes the flow. It opens you up to all kinds of deceit and compromise. I'm telling you, people, God's calling you to do exploits. He wants you to be captivated by his glory. He wants you to be set apart in a realm so holy. I want you to listen tonight and tell you right now. I promise you. You do not want anything but Jesus. You do not want anything but heaven. You do not want anything but the realms of the Holy Ghost. You do not want anything but faith. You do not want anything but this life. And God has set forth the proofs that no man need to walk in darkness nor ignorance. For there's the indicators and the evidence all about us as to whether or not we're doing what God says, or we're adding to it or taking away from it. And if you add to it, the deception is so great that the plagues will be added to you. If you take away from it, it results in deception once again, so that your name will be taken out of the book of life. You can't add to it. You can't take from it. And if you just enter into this place of fellowship with Him, where all you want is Him, where all you want is the exploits of God in your life, where all you want to do is advance the kingdom of God, all you want to do is live the life of Jesus as He modeled it for us. Come on, people. Quit writing your own experience and your own will and your own ideas into God's word and into God's will, because it just doesn't hold water. It's earthen vessels that cannot hold water. Brother, let's just stand up and begin to move in a realm of obedience to God, that the great exploits of faith may be revealed in our lives. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hurasati de Vestina. Hamblekana. The Holy Spirit will train you how to praise most excellently. I promise you, you will never be bored in worship again, but captivated. I promise you, you'll never do it for men again, but for Him alone, and it will be a whole nother realm. You let me give me somebody who has separated themselves to the praise only unto God, and it fills the atmosphere when they begin to sing. Their purity, their consecration has an effect on everything, even the flowers, even the plastic. Plants begin to move. God wants to make you great. God wants to do great exploits through you. Faith is the supernatural ability to do God's works, to do the works of God. Roshapina. Shiponatea. Silimasata. Silamositorona Masea. Sitanea. We just take the basket. We breathe in the basket. And everything that comes in begins to be multiplied. Amen. Suddenly the figures can't add up. It seemed to be one thing in the ledger, and then it's another thing in the account. Where did it come from? If we get audited, it's supernatural. Hey, you put this much in and ended up having that much more when it got there. Where did the rest come from? Huh? You don't get penalized for having a more abundance. You only get penalized for lack. You know what I'm saying? If you got the minuses, you get penalized because you can't account for where all the money was spent, right? Huh? You got less money there than what you should have. But when you got more, nobody's concerned. No one's too concerned. God doesn't want you to have lack. There is no lack in Him, but you've got to do it His way. You can't pollute the flow. You can't have doubt and unbelief and expect faith to work. Breathe upon your life and see the miracle working power of God set upon you, rest upon you. But with that anointing, there has to be a following through. There has to be an obedience. You have to be husband. You have to have a husband. You have to be the husbandry. You have to have a husbandman, one who tendeth thee. You don't start screaming when He fertilizes you. You don't start saying, what are you doing now, when he starts cutting your beautiful branch short and scalping you and taking the one most lovely, well-formed branches that you are most proud of and taking it all the way back to the nub. To the nub. Where you finally were getting somewhere and you finally were moving forward and it finally looked like increase and God just shut it down. He shut it down. You might be bring forth more fruit than it might be stronger and bigger and more lasting and more fortified against every element that would try to destroy it. Hear me. This is the good way of God. Amen. Come into his husbandry. Come on. Amen. Let him do it the way he wants to do it. Amen. Come under his rod. Yes. Come under his rule. Amen. Fall upon the rock and be broken. Come on now. Tonight. Fall upon the rock and be broken. Say, Lord, to do thy will, O God. This is my delight. I delight, O God, to do thy will. It's all I want in my life. I don't want to speak my own words. I don't want to find my own pleasure. I don't want to live my own life. I want to call that which you have set apart and consecrated holy and the anointed of the Lord honorable. Cease to do my own will and to speak my own words, O Lord, that you may feed me with the heritage of Jacob, that I may walk upon my high places. Hallelujah. 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 I will not stand back and watch people self-destruct. You know what I'll do? I'll give you some soft little expressions. It won't be long. I'll take the trumpet and blow it in your ear. I'll blow it in your ear. I'll lift up my voice and I'll shout. People, it's the hardness of heart that would cause such a thing to happen. You got to let your heart be soft. You don't have to get God to do things. He's already done them. He wants to show us how to be yielded and submitted to him. Just yield it. Just yield it. Yield it as a state of worship. It is a state of relationship. It is a state of praise. Everybody I've ever known who did great things in God, if they were asked, if they understood what happened, when William Branham was asked, how do you flow in such accurate words of knowledge? How do these miracles take place? He said just simply, I just stay yielded. When T.L. Osborne, the list goes on, I just stay yielded. Just stay yielded. William Wigglesworth, I delight in him. I'm captivated by him. I'm beholding the glory. What are you talking about? It's hard. I can't break away. Many people today, it's the opposite. They can't break away from all the stuff that they've got going on in their life. Their life. Provable. Definable. Their life. And God's exploits won't work there. And they're trying to break away from that. To be captivated by him. And they have moments of captivation and then they just return and they go back to living out a temporal existence that will cease and be no more. Father, tonight we'd love to do work in your life, in our lives, to where we're so captivated by him, we're disinterested. An older man of God told me one time, he said, just spend a long time fasting and you will begin to lose all of your interest and ambition. You will have no more motivation to go to work. You will have no more motivation to succeed in the kingdom of men. You'll be captivated by the life of God. And he was right. He was right. Wonderful thing about fasting and praying is if you've got addictions in your life, many of them people have, they don't even know it. Addictions to reading the newspaper, Because they're saturated by the sensation and the drama of the fiction that they have imposed as a reality upon themselves. And it's like a soap opera and who's going to marry who. And what next disaster will take place. Suddenly you deal with it and you'll wake up to you don't want it anymore. And the radio and the television and all the other stuff that has created for you a fantasy, a mental condition that is clinical. It's pathological. It's true. But just because you're with the rest of the clinical, pathological nutcases, you look normal and feel okay. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I'm telling you, you listen to me, I'm telling you. A one-eyed man is a hero among the blind. It is time we step up a little higher. It's time we step up a little higher. It's time we step up a little. It's time we reach a little higher. Come on. It's time we move in with a greater passion and ferocity and forcefulness and zeal and determination. What Father's looking for. He sees it in me tonight and he loves every bit of it. And he created it and all I did was respond to it and nurture it and let it become a raging fire. I don't like little fires. Right now out on the ranch, we're getting ready to go into the burn season. And for the past month, we've been stacking up things that need to be burned. And some of the stacks and some of the piles reach high up to the lights. And in the near future, we're going to take a match. We'll do it in the evening. And stand there and watch this blazing fire that will burn all night into the next day and into the next night. A blazing fire that cannot be quenched, that burns bright with the fullness of his God's glory, the light of Jesus. It cannot be compromised. It cannot fit into our other things. It won't stand along other idols and other interests. God calls you to set yourself apart to that which he set you apart to be. He sanctified you that you may set yourself apart and sanctify yourself in him. To be consecrated. Oh, to such a life as this. To such a glorious life as this. Say, Holy Spirit. Say, Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
Take my life.
Take my life.
And place me upon the altar of your praise.
Place me on the altar of your praise.
Let your fire fall.
Let your fire fall.
Let your fire burn in me.
Let your fire burn in me.
Jesus. Spirit of the Lord is here and he's breathing so strong upon us. The life and the glory of God is so real here in this place. All you have to do is just open up the door of your heart just a little bit and God will come rushing in. Just open up the door of your heart just a little bit. Just open up the door of your heart just a little bit. Just open up the door of your heart just a little bit and God will come rushing in. Just open up the door of your heart just a little bit and God will come rushing in. Jesus, he's here. He stands banging at the door of your heart and he says, open it up. And I'll come fellowship with you. I promise you that when Jesus steps into the room of your life, the light and the glory of God will come and he will be the center of attention. All other interests will go. Oh, dear people, understand. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Understand what it means when the living God steps in. When the light steps in and all the darkness goes away. Watch what happens when fellowship with him becomes what it should be. And there's no room for praises for anyone but him. There's a love that captivates our soul that causes us to know what love is. I mean, I can only truly love my wife because I've learned to love him and let his love flow through me. He becomes the definition of everything that I am and my ability to express anything that is good. Thank you, Jesus. God loves you so much. He proved it again and again and gave his only begotten son for you. God loves you so much, he gave you the most precious thing, the most precious gifts that he had. Gave to us the Holy Spirit. He wants to bring forth something so pure in our lives that it's only his sound and not ours. Take my life and let it be, Lord, consecrated, Lord, to thee. Come and play now. I heard you play. Start playing. God started playing 5 minutes ago. The Holy Ghost started doing it 5 minutes ago. You should do it with them. It works better. Everybody stand with me, please. You think it's about performance. It's not. It's about learning how to yield to God. You think it is about what you can do and what another can do and whether or not you got praises or got reprimanded. No, it's about you being willing to be trained to live out the life that God has and understand how to yield him, move him. Why do you think so wrong? Because you've been conditioned by men to think the way you think. God's here to retrain us to walk in the mind of the Spirit, to walk in the mind of Christ, which is living by the Word. Come live. Go ahead, I want you to play. I can't hear you. Go ahead and play. Play. Let the cloud of glory come rushing through your life. Let the wind of the Spirit come flow through you. Here's what I know God would do if he would let him. He would stop and shut down every attachment that you have going on in your life that does not 100% belong to heaven. That's what he would do. I can't hear you. You want to, some other musicians, you want to come and play? I can't hear you, son. They don't have you turned up. So it's just like, sounds like you're tuning to me. It's a distraction. I need to play. Just come play the keys. Come play the keys. Something that can be heard. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, living God. Let the Lord search your heart tonight. Let Him help you with your divided interest, but coming and filling you with all of His. Come now, play. Come on now. This is not right. This is ridiculous. Have I got musicians or no? Just go ahead and play something that could be heard. I just like flowing with the Holy Ghost. Sometimes the Spirit of the Lord just wants it to be silent, and I go with that. Sometimes there's supposed to be music, but I have to have people who are understand how to operate that with that. And this is where Father's at. He's got a will and a mind of things that He wants to do in the earth, but He has to have the people who's going to cooperate. He's got to have somebody who's going to speak on His behalf and do it the way He's designed to do it, and not let it be a mixture. Too many things have started off about praising God, and it ended up with praising men. Too many things looked like it was going to be something about glorifying Jesus, and it ended up being something that glorified some company, some individual, some business, some particular ministry. It's true. It's defiled. Doesn't it? It's not going to make the cut. Take my life and let it be. Just play that song. Hallelujah. Consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Blessed is the holy name of Jesus. Blessed is the holy name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Where's Crystal at? Crystal, come play. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Thank you, Jesus. Play deeper and deeper still. I don't want to put a song on you that you don't know how to play potentially. Just because it's just such a good worship song you can play it. You know, the Lord has many things that He would have us do in Him, but many times He's simply limited to what faith we've allowed to be developed in our life. And so He can only use us within the confinement of that development. And His will is that there be no confinement and there be no limitation upon it. So that whatever He requests, it happens. So if He says, take my will and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. It breaks out into a full-blown orchestra of beauty and splendor in the anointing of the Holy Ghost. But if all you have is a guitar that can't be heard, that's it. And it's just a great analogy to the where our lives are and what we've allowed God to do and develop in our lives. And it leaves a great void, doesn't it? It leaves a great giant void. Unprepared, void. And I want you and I to respond to Him tonight that there be no void. that there be no deficiencies, that there be no lack. That when he says, speak to the wind and waves, he's got somebody to do it. When he says, go out there, lay hands on that paraplegic now because I want to heal them. We're not just saying God wants to heal the paraplegic tonight, because that's about our limitation. We can give a word of knowledge. This is what God wants to do, but the power to produce it's not there. Why? Because it's the development of faith that has to come through a consecration of living for Him. Jesus. Come on now. Everybody that's watching me on the web right now, you listen to me. Jesus. Everybody that's studying this place, listen to me. Let God touch you now. The things that you're holding on to your own life, I pray that they become profane to you. I was telling some people the other day, if everybody would get excited about Jesus as they are about Trump, and I cannot even imagine, it doesn't even make sense to me how that Christians, God's people, can be so bought in with that. Can't even imagine. But at the same time, I monitor you guys' post, and I'm God's scribe. One for Jesus, 20 for you. One for Jesus. Some of you are 1 to 5s. One for Jesus, 5 for you. Spotlight's on you. How do you feel? Are you drawing back? Feel like someone's picking on you? Caught in the act? Feel justified? It's just a measure, people, of who we're living for and what we're excited about. Let it change tonight. Let it change. Let it change tonight. You know, I can't go down to the church down the street and begin to preach to them about revival, but I can look at you and I can demand change. I can look at you and I can demand a change so much that you won't even be comfortable being around me if you just want to go on doing what it is you do. Because if you want to go on doing what you do, all you're going to be doing, you're going to be addicted to the praises of men and you won't be getting it here. You have to go somewhere where somebody's going to praise you, tell you how wonderful you are and how great you're doing as you give yourself to the right ways of this world. Not going to happen here. Not going to happen in His kingdom. Everybody going to be bowed low. Bowed low. Huh. Jesus. 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 Can you know, do you know how to play Take My Life and Let It Be? Do you know how to do it? Because I just, it's just such on me in the spirit. Just so on me. I want to lead you in it and sing this song tonight. Hallelujah.
Take my hand.
Sing it again.
Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne.
Your hands up in total surrender, run to the living God. And let that which only the Spirit of the Lord can do. And believe me, He will do it. He will do it. In any honest and true and sincere heart that's not holding on to their own life, He will do it. Take my life and be consecrated, Lord, to me. Take my moments.
Take my moments.
Lift your hands towards heaven. Yield yourself to the Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit, we ask you to take care of our lives and play the emotions and passions and desires of our heart. As a master musician plays the songs of praise upon the string instrument. Let the beauty, O God, of that which belongs to your glory and to your anointing, that which belongs to your splendor and power and divine majesty, arise in the midst of your people, O God. Arise, O Lord. Let there be light in the earth, O God. Let there be the glory of your presence. Let there be the majesty of your presence. be revealed in our midst, O God, and the things that would somehow dampen you or shut you out or shade you. May they be removed from our life from this night, from this moment, forever. Lord, that we may be trained and prepared unto every good work, that when you're ready for the orchestra, it breaks into the song. When you're ready for the miracle, it begins to be done. When you're ready for the healing streams to flow, there are those who know how to go there and move with you. Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. We never want to do anything to offend you. We never want to do anything that would shut you out. We want to learn to move with you and yield ourselves to you. Do this now, O God. Do this now. Do this now, Lord. Do this now. Jesus. Be glorified in us. Be glorified. Just come, everyone, just come stand up here with me. Hallelujah. Let the wind of heaven sweep you away. The glory of God is here. Let him just touch you. Let him captivate your passion and your emotion right now. Let God, the Holy Spirit, listen, let God, the Holy Spirit, begin to express a whole new dimension of affection and love through you towards him. Thank you, Lord Jesus.